and welcome to What's New from BBC Africa. I'm Debula. Coming up on today's program, is ballet for everyone? We'll be meeting young talented dancers from Nairobi who want to prove just that.
I loved ballet because I could see people dancing and the feeling just got to me. So I said when I grow up, I want to be a ballet dancer.
What do you want to be when you grow up? A top footballer tells us why playing a sport can help you achieve your dreams. Garbage in the galaxy. We'll find out why there's so much rubbish in outer space and why it could be a problem here on Earth. We'll also get an insider's guide to the coolest places and the best things to do in Guinea's capital, Conakry. All that and much more coming up on BBC What's New. Welcome to BBC What's New. Now, ballet might not be popular in many African countries, but that could be changing as more children give it a go. Young people who are learning to dance in one of Kenya's poorest areas say it's a great way to express yourself and deal with stress. They say it can even change lives. Let's find out more.
When I dance ballet, it changes my life living in Kibera because I've discovered that this is my talent and I want to grow it. I am Ida. I come from Kibera and I am 13 years old. I started dancing ballet from class 1 up until now. It's been 7 years. We are taught by Anos Africa and they made us discover our talent. I loved ballet because I could see people dancing and the feeling just got to me. So I said when I grow up, I want to be a ballet dancer. I feel flexible and I also feel like it takes away my stress. My parents support me dancing ballet. I am happy when I dance with my friends Cynthia, Valerie, Isaiah, and Juliet. Ballet is good and it can make you recognize your talent. And also, if you think it's only for the white people, that's not true. Anyone can do it. When I grow up, it can help me come back to the slum and help other kids recognize their talents. One day, we'll be a big team and help each other.
Let's go to Tanzania now. There's been a terrible tragedy. More than 200 people died after a ferry, the MV Nyerere, sank in Lake Victoria last week. The president declared 4 days of national mourning after the accident, and people have been burying their loved ones. But how did this happen?
It's reported that the ferry's official capacity was 100 people, but officials say the vessel was carrying more than twice that number when it capsized. The ferry was transporting people and cargo on a busy route between the islands of Ukara and Ukerewe, which are close to Tanzania's second largest city of Mwanza. The ferry crosses between the islands as many as 8 times a day. But this is not the first time a ferry is capsizing in Tanzania. There have been accidents before on Lake Victoria. The worst was in 1996, when more than 800 people died when the MV Bukoba capsized in Lake Victoria. It was one of the worst ferry disasters of the last century. When the MV Nyerere sank in Lake Victoria, it was only 50 meters away from the shore, but many of the passengers were not able to swim. But there were some survivors.
We were just about to dock when it overturned due to the load he was carrying, and we found ourselves in the water. I thank God because I was able to jump out of the ferry and held onto an object nearby. And that's how I survived.
The ferry overturned very fast and covered us. I was lucky that I was able to swim underwater whilst not knowing where I was swimming to. I knew I was very near the ferry.
And the government is doing something about it. Some people who work at the port have been sacked and others arrested. And experts are investigating exactly what went wrong to make sure it doesn't happen again.
Now, let's take a look at some stories making the news this week. Children in South Africa could have a new class on their schedule, Swahili language lessons. From 2020, it will be taught in schools there as an optional subject. Swahili is the most widely spoken African language on the continent. And over the border in Namibia, the government says people will no longer be able to open their own private schools. They want to promote free government primary education instead. Other FIFA awards in London, Egyptian star Mo Salah, who plays for Liverpool, won the Best Goal of the Year award. It was for his sensational strike against Everton in December. Croatia's Luka Modric was named Best Male Footballer, while Brazilian striker Marta Vera da Silva was awarded Best Female Player for the sixth time in a row. And finally, music star turned politician Bobby Wine is back home in Uganda. He was in the United States for medical treatment. Bobby Wine was arrested in August and claims he was beaten by soldiers while in custody. But the Ugandan army denies that. Now, don't forget, if you want to know more about who Bobby Wine is and what's been happening in Uganda, you can find out on our YouTube page. Just go to youtube.com/BBC What's New.
Hey, you're watching BBC What's New.
Now, I was never as sporty as this guy, but I'm quite good at picking up new things, I think. Including golf. But I don't think I'll ever be as good as our next guest. Chanel Wangara is changing the face of golf in Africa. She's only 11, but she's already competing in major golf tournaments in the world and could be on her way to becoming the new Tiger Woods. Here's her story.
When I first started, I was like playing for fun to enjoy. Then that really made me enjoy the game because it was fun trying to hit the ball kind of hard. My name is Chanel Wangari. I'm 11 years old, and one of my titles was the Africa Junior Golf Challenge. I was the winner. The first day of school, they gave us a list to choose the spot you want to go to, and most of my friends were going for golf, so I decided to go for golf. This year I was ninth in the world out of 117 girls of my age. On school days, on weekdays, I concentrate on school. I don't think about golf. After the day finishes for school, then my mom can pick me up for golf. A lot of kids in this world, I know they love watching TV and on the laptop and phones and going outside. I don't say that's bad, but I think they should stand up, get off the couch and come outside, do any sport that you think is good. There was this time I was on the last hole and we were all square, like they were good players. Everyone was out, my teammates were there crossing their fingers so I could like make the putt. Then turned out I made the putt, everybody started jumping and screaming, and we ended up the winners of last year. I look up to Rory McIlroy. He's a PGA Tour professional and he's real good. He has a good attitude and he has a good swing also. I like to be like him when I grow up. I like to win a lot of trophies and a lot of money.
Coming up on BBC What's New.
I am the lioness of Africa. Whenever I go out, I rise.
We'll be getting some inspirational life lessons from one of Ghana's most promising young musicians. Now, let's go to Conakry in Guinea. As part of a series where we ask you to be our tour guide, Jamila shows us around the city.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Jamila.
Hello, my name is Jamila. I'm 12 years old. Welcome to my beautiful city of Conakry. Conakry is very beautiful. It's full of buildings and roads. It's full of life and is a joyful place to be. Football in Guinea is a national sport, and I come here to play with my friends. After a good football session, it's time for food. Let's go and eat something. We have here some typical Guinean dishes. We have couscous made from corn, which we eat with yogurt. We often eat this dish during special ceremonies. It is offered as a sign of respect. Welcome to Koloma Market. The rain doesn't stop anything. In this market, there is food from all over the country, and we use them to make delicious meals. This is the National Museum. Follow me for a guided tour. Let me show you the nimba. Here in Guinea, the nimba is a symbol of fertility. And traditionally, women who want to have a baby tie a string from the mask around the waist. Here we have a talking drum. The talking drum was used in ancient times as a way of communicating. The messages were coded, which meant only those initiated to the sacred forest could understand them. One thing I would change is to make the government take better care of people. I would like to see roads in a better condition. They are not bad, but I think they could be better. To people who have never visited Guinea, I would say, come, because it's a beautiful country.
Thanks, Jamila. Would love to visit Conakry. Now, what do you want to be when you grow up? You might know, or you might not know yet. Or you might just change your mind later anyway. I wanted to be a chemist, but that didn't work out. So sometimes it can be hard to achieve your dreams. But can playing a sport teach us about success? Kesha has been finding out.
What do sports and your future career have in common? Nothing, you might say, but then you'd be wrong. These girls in Lagos have been hanging out with some of the country's top football and basketball players, learning how sports principles can help them in their future careers. Joyce likes sports, but doesn't want to be an athlete. Let's find out what she learned.
My name is Iwu Joyce. I'm 16 years old. I want to be a pilot. My favorite sport is running.
There are principles in sports that can help you no matter your chosen career. Precious is a former Nigerian footballer who's played in 3 Women's World Cups. She says 5 traits helped her to be successful, and they'll help you too.
Education, dedication, determination, discipline, and passion. I think those 5 things can help anybody in her chosen career.
Let's see how Joyce has been getting on.
I'm like a football player. I was not able to make it, but the man, he said I should focus on the ball and my head should be straight up. I should not use my head, I should use my forehead. So I tried it once. I could not get it. Second time, but the third time I made it correctly.
Let's go.
I want to be a pilot so I can see different places, learn more of the world. Sports teaches us determination and practice. When you practice, you get it. So you just keep on practicing, then you'll be the champion, you'll be the best.
Okay, but have you learned anything new?
One thing I've learned today is to be focused. And I'll never forget it, because when you're focused, no distraction from any side ever affects you.
And there you have it. You don't have to be an athlete to enjoy the benefits of sports principles in your future career.
Still on sport, let's talk about football. A growing number of young footballers, either born or raised in Europe, are opting to play for African countries. Stoke City striker Saido Berahino, who came to England as a young boy, is the latest to take that route. He's just decided to play for Burundi, having played for England 47 times in different youth age groups. This is what he had to say after his first match for Burundi.
Hi guys, my name is Saido Berahino, from Burundi. And I play for Stoke City. It was just an unbelievable feeling, you know, playing back where for my country, where originally I was from. And it couldn't have gone any better. I managed to get a goal on my debut. So for a striker, I was really pleased with my work. And also my family back home here as well was waiting patiently to see my debut. And I think I made them all happy with scoring a goal. And she was the first one to call me after I scored that goal after the game ended and congratulated me. So I was just so happy I can put a smile on their face. They approached me from a young age, and I just thought as a player I wasn't ready yet to take that challenge. And I'm 25 years old now, and I believe that I'm ready to take them challenges, and that's why I went and decided to play for my country, because playing for your country is not just about going and playing football. It's more than that. It means a lot to everybody that playing. So I had to make sure I was ready and I was matured enough to take them that challenge, which is why I made the choice now.
We've all heard about how important it is not to litter, and that we should recycle our waste at home. Now, there are concerns about the amount of rubbish floating around in space. We rely on satellites in space for things like mobile phones, TV and GPS. But as more of them are launched, the risk of space debris increases. In a moment, we'll find out why it's such a problem. But first, let's take a look at what's being done about it.
From old bits of rocket to small tools dropped by spacewalking astronauts, there's more than 7,500 tons of rubbish circling the Earth. That's as much as 4,500 cars or 10,000 cows. For the first time, scientists have used a special satellite to try and clear some of it up. It works by using a big net to catch the space debris, which then burns up in the atmosphere as the net drags it back down to Earth. The satellite is also going to try and clear up more bits of rubbish in space by spearing it with a harpoon. So far, these have just been tests, but ideas like this are much needed to try and stop space debris from becoming a big problem.
Now, you might think that there's enough room out there for all of our space junk. It's outer space, right? Well, wrong. Space debris can affect us here on Earth. Maggie, who's a space expert, tells us why.
We launched our first artificial satellite, artificial machine into space in 1957. That was just over 60 years ago. Since then, we've been putting more and more things up there. Now, this isn't a general problem, but every so often these things collide. And when they do, they form space debris. Now, let's imagine you're on the International Space Station. It's like a huge hotel up in space. If this space debris hits the International Space Station, it could cause a leak. And that means the air inside the International Space Station will escape. It can also hit other satellites. Satellites do all sorts of things for us. They help us with our navigation. They actually give us an understanding of what our planet Earth is doing. And so if they get damaged, it affects us here on Earth. So space debris is becoming more and more of a problem, and it will be in the future.
Thank you, Maggie. Now, our next guest is one of Ghana's most promising young musicians. Wiyaala is currently on a world tour. And as well as reaching new fans with her music, she's keen to spread a positive message about how we should live our lives. Ben went to meet her. I wanna feel the
growing up in a place with no electricity, to touring the world.
Yeah, whenever I go out, I...
This is one girl who doesn't let her beginnings shape her future.
Growing up in my village, we didn't have electricity. No light. Nope.
No.
In 2012, we got electricity. But when I was small, I used to watch TV for 3 hours, 30 minutes. So they had this huge generator. They just started to, and you all run into the house, 6:30 to 9:30. So I'll be watching, and I saw Madonna singing. I always fell in love with you. She's like, oh, I'm like, wow. I will sing like this woman.
From that moment, Wiyaala made the most of every single opportunity to perform.
When I got the chance to go to secondary school, that was my chance. Because every Saturday we had entertainment night, and I never missed my opportunity. And I will gather the children and tell them, look, you be the audience, I'm Madonna.
Wiyaala's professional career started when she saw an advert on TV, but it still wasn't an easy journey.
One day I was watching TV and they say, do you want to be a star? You can sing, you can do this. I said, yeah, yeah. It was called Stars of the Future, and I went to the audition. First year I was a no. The next year I went back, I was on standby. Finally they dropped me. Third year I went back again and I made it to final 12. Unfortunately I didn't win. Then the fourth year, I was back again.
You went back?
I was back again. Then this time Ryan was like, I was never more than prepared. I won, hands down, and everything just started like accumulated. I wanna feel the heat.
Wiyaala was always bullied just because of her looks.
When I was a child, even at the age of 6, people used to ask my mom, is she a boy or a girl? Because I just didn't look like a girl to them. They call me Balore Pefanga.
What does that mean?
Ugly strong. Like if my sister got into a fight, she just called, I'm calling Wiyaala, they all ran away. I didn't care. I just said, look, all of you insulting me when they went and see me on TV. They say, oh, TV, you from this village, we don't have electricity. So I got into the industry and everybody was telling me to be more feminine, more feminine. They just want you to be Beyonce or Rihanna. That light skin and the big hair and all that. But I like short hair. I've always liked short hair. It just made me feel cool. So one day I just took the machine and went zzz, zzz.
Wow.
And when I got out, people were like, and they were like, what? Whoa, what is that? And at a point I just said, you know what? So I'm different. And so, wait, the difference is actually making me stand out. So I'm gonna build on it.
Now she uses her platform to try and change the world.
Now I'm popular, everybody listen to you. So I have to use the voice wisely, like end child marriage. I have friends who were taken out from school when we were growing up. And you go back, you see them, they all have babies, they are at the market, sitting on the floor, looking all, it's not cool. Now they've named me after a street in that town, Wiyaala Street. That was when
Wiyaala
I realized.
Wiyaala Street?
Wiyaala Street. That is when I realized that, wow, I have made an impact. Sometimes, I don't know whether it's luck, faith, belief, and taking my chances and taking my opportunities. When I see one, I'm just happy.
That. Well, that's all from me this week, but don't forget, we want to hear from you. If you've got any great ideas or stories you want to share with us, just send us an email to whatsnew@bbc.co.uk. In the meantime, see you next time on What's New. Bye.